Okay, we were here last week, right? And we heard Do Not Commit Adultery, part one. This is now part two. Actually, I mentioned to Pastor Jess that they practically covered, all the verses on adultery. And so there's nothing much to talk about, so we'll just pray for the adulterers right now. Okay, so do we have some adulterers? We're all adulterers in our heart, whether we like to believe that or not. But practically, I believe that this is something that we have to constantly realize. And our title for this series is Be Pure, Fight God's Battles. Let's all say that together. Be pure, fight God's battles. Okay, so let's just read 2 Samuel chapter 11. Bear with me. I just want us to have a more thorough grasp of the entire chapter because we will be dealing with this chapter in detail. Most of the time, we're so aware with the entire flow, the story. It has been told, retold several times. But I believe that there are some details here that will help us understand the anatomy of what we are dealing with David's fall. So let's all read it together. In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David sent Joab out with the king's men, the whole Israel army. Read on. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was, and David, man said, then, she went back home. So David, when Uriah came to him, go down to your house and wash your feet. So Uriah left the palace, and a gift from the king was sent after him. But Uriah slept at the entrance of the palace with all his master's servants and did not go down to his house. Let's all bow down in a short word of prayer. Father, we thank you for allowing us this chance to truly meditate upon your word. We believe, Lord, that your word is a two-edged sword. Your word is so rich. Your word, O God, is your instrument, your conduit for your power to transform and change our lives. Father, we pray that your word will be the priority of our lives. Lord, we just commit to you our time together. We thank you that you allowed us to just sing songs to you, songs of praise, songs of worship. We pray that our minds and our hearts will be focused on you. We ask for your holy presence to minister to our individual situations, our individual challenges, our personal circumstances, because we know that you care for us. We believe that you will speak to us, and we thank you for each and everyone. We thank you for the ministry here. Lord, we give you praise, and we trust in your holy presence. In your name, amen. And so we are now dealing with David's fall into adultery, but I think the first thing that I would like us to underscore here is the fact that we are fighting God's battles. That is the key to the purity that is being spoken of as we go through this. And the first principle I want us to understand regarding being pure, fighting God's battle, it is in the aspect of fighting God's battles against the self-centered purpose and pleasure. Fight God's battles against self-centered purpose and pleasure. And practically, we saw that in the previous week that we dealt with this, and we were able to emphasize that it was a time in the spring, it was a time when kings go off to war. It was a time when they would practically just go into the battle of God, because at this point in their history, they have not yet conquered the promised land. The promised land will be within their scope of rulership and sovereignty by the time of King Solomon. But prior to King Solomon, much of the land still had to be conquered. The Philistines were there. The other Canaanite tribes were all over the place. And it was a time to go to war. But the question is, what happened to David? What did he do? He remained in Jerusalem, and he sent Joab out with the king's men and the whole Israelite army. And we see clearly that David missed out on the purpose. His purpose as the king of the chosen people of God, the king of Israel, ang purpose po niya is to conquer the promised land. The question is, are we conquering the promised land? Are we going off to war in our personal lives? Because the key to purity, the key to holiness, the key to being set free, first and foremost, is for us to understand that we have to fight God's battles against self-centered purpose and pleasure. And that's the issue here. David was supposed to go out to war. One of the key reasons why he fell into adultery was because he was not fighting the battles of God for the Lord's glory. He was not fighting the battles of God. And what is God fighting against in our personal life? He is fighting against our self-centeredness. He is fighting against the I, me, mine mentality. He is fighting against the getting, grabbing, collecting mentality. And I think that's very important and very clear here. The question is, how do we see this in our lives? How do we apply this in our lives? Because we are all pursuing our respective careers, jobs. Many of us are into our entrepreneurial endeavors. Many of us are into our professions. Many of us are holding a job, or maybe we have a livelihood. But the question is, are we fighting God's battles against self-centered purpose and pleasure? What is your purpose in your office? Beautiful question. What is the main purpose for each and every one of us in our respective business? Because that is exactly what we have to understand. The key to purity is to fight God's battles against our selfish purpose. To fight God's battles against our selfish plans and programs. And we see here that David, who was supposed to be with the army, with Joab, remained in Jerusalem. And that is something that we should reflect upon. Are we going out to war? Can you ask your seatmate, are you at war? Are you at war? Not with your wife, not with your children, but are we at war? What are we fighting for? Are we simply fighting for a promotion? Are we simply fighting for a new gadget? Or are we fighting for the purpose of God? Are we fighting the battles of the Lord? Interesting question, right? Because this is the key to purity. We want to overcome. We want to rise above our challenges. This is the key. It says here in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11, flee from these things, okay? You flee from these things. But what next? You man of God, and pursue. What are we pursuing? Is it righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, gentleness? The same thing with 2 Timothy chapter 2. Flee from youthful lust and pursue righteousness. What are we pursuing? In fact, even in James chapters 4, verse 7 to 8, we see that It says, submit therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. And we see that all of this is a clear statement to us that to rise above temptation, it's not just that we should submit to God, resist the devil, but we must draw near to God, cleanse our hands, purify our hearts. We pursue righteousness. What are we pursuing? Is this guy familiar? Is this guy familiar to us? His name is Gordon MacDonald, and he's one of the most prolific writers, well known for his books. His most popular book is the one over here, Ordering Your Private World. When he wrote that book, it became a Golden Dove Award. It became a Golden Dove awardee. Nakatanggap po yung libro na yan ng Golden Dove. It is the highest award given to Christian books. But after that happened, he fell into adultery. He was disciplined. He was restored. And he wrote another book called Rebuilding Your Broken World. Once again, it became a Golden Dove awardee. Gifted guy. No question about that. The gifts and calling are irrevocable. Truly a gifted person, but there is one line here in this book that really made me understand something very important. Because prior to his falling into adultery, Gordon MacDonald said that he has a strength when it comes to moral issues. He said, if there is one area in my life I will not fall into, it will be adultery. But that was before he fell. So when he wrote this book, Rebuilding Your Broken World, he said one line there that never left me. He said, unguarded strength is double weakness. Let's all say that together. Unguarded strength is double weakness. Once again, unguarded strength is double weakness. And he said the reason he fell was he thought he was strong. He was not guarding his strength, and that's why it became a double one time, his coach, when he was still in college, very much younger than what he looks like here, he was still in college, he was a sprinter, and he was trained by his coach to have the stamina towards the end of a sprint. And so he was advised by his coach. He said, you are going out there with one of the top guys, but I trained you for stamina. So these are my instructions, the coach said. You are going to just be a few inches behind him. Just trail him. Do not go toe-to-toe with this guy. Just trail him a few inches behind. And then on the last stretch, that's where you give the strength that you were trained for, the stamina that you need. And so Gordon MacDonald said, okay, coach, I get the strategy, the plan. Let's do it. Problem was, when he was starting off with the top guy of that race, at some point he saw the women on the side, you know, and he wanted to impress them. You know, he felt that, you know, maybe if they see me, you know, going toe-to-toe with this guy, you know, the girls there will be cheering, swooning over me, etc. So what did he do? At the beginning of the race, he started to be on the same distance with the top guy. So what happened was, towards the last stretch, he lost his strength. He was no longer able to really run faster, and so the top guy just left him. To make a long story short, he lost the race. But I like the conversation. Just watch, listen to the conversation. Coach Goldberg to Gordon MacDonald, and he was still in college. Let's read it all together. Maybe this will make us allow the message to sink in. I'm not half as concerned about the fact that the race was lost as I am about the habit pattern I see in you. You do not listen well, and this problem is going to mark your entire life. It is beginning to look to me as if you will have to learn all the important lessons of life the hard way, instead of learning from those who can point the way for you. I wonder how many more races you'll have to lose before you master these things. And I wonder how many mistakes you will make in life until you figure this out. This was still during the time that he was in college. This was still during the time that he was not yet a pastor. He was not yet a writer. And yet the coach hit the nail on the head, right on target. Most especially the last lines. I wonder how many more races you'll have to lose before you master these things. And I wonder how many mistakes you'll make in life until you figure this out. Bullseye! Beautiful question. And I think we should always ask ourselves, are we fighting the right battles? Are we just fighting for a promotion? Are we just fighting for a sale? Are we just fighting for money? Are we just fighting for gadgets, for a new, you know, set of possessions, new material treasures? Or are we fighting for the purpose of God? Because the only way we are going to rise above and be set free to live a life of purity, it's for us to pursue and fight the battles of God. So once again, what's our theme? Be pure. Fight God's battles. Okay, so here's the situation. Evening, David goes up from his bed, walks around the roof of the palace. It's not really evening in the real sense of evening. It was late afternoon. That's their description of evening there during that time, culturally. Late afternoon, so you can still see things around you. And of course, most of these houses had yards where they take a bath. Of course, from the outside, on their level, they could not be seen. But from the roof, most especially from the palace, situated on a mountainous region of Jerusalem, the palace itself was overlooking several houses. And so he looks out. There was a woman. And guess what? It was very beautiful. Taking a bath. What does he do? He sends someone to find out about her. Then he sends messengers to her. Then he sleeps with her. What do we see here? What are we fighting for? Predator. Like alien versus predator. We must wage war against the predator within. We must wage God's war against the predator within. And that's something we see very clearly here. The predator within David was clearly screaming. Most especially the fact that Bathsheba was the daughter of Eliam. And in 2 Samuel chapter 23 verse 34, you can just write that down. But according to scholars, they connect the names and they realize there is a great possibility that Bathsheba was the granddaughter of David's counselor named Ahithophel. Bathsheba was most probably, according to these scholars, the granddaughter of David's counselor, Ahithophel. Who's Uriah the Hittite? Uriah the Hittite is one of the 30 mighty men of David. These mighty men were with David from the beginning of his campaign, from the beginning of his running away as a fugitive from Saul. These 30 men, or some of these 30 men, were already with David. They're like the presidential security guard, the close-in security guards of the king. So these are not strangers, friends. But you notice, David doesn't give a hoot. He doesn't care. He wasn't thinking about them. He wasn't thinking about Bathsheba, the daughter of my counselor. He wasn't thinking of Uriah, one of my 30 mighty men. No, he was not. He was just thinking about his libido. He was just thinking about his sexual desires. He was just thinking about his pleasure. And at this point in time, David had several wives, for crying out loud. Ang dami niya asawa. Meron siyang pang Monday, pang Tuesday, pang Wednesday, pang Thursday. And yet, he looked out the way and he was practically not fighting the battle, not waging war against the predator within, the sinful nature within, which was very, very important. And I think that's something that we must always remember, friends. There is a predator within that we need to deal with. And if we do not deal with this, then definitely we will not understand that there are monsters inside of us that we are practically feeding when we do not fight God's war against this inner darkness. And that's what we see here. He wasn't concerned about anything. He wasn't concerned about the lives around. Predatory hearts are heartless towards lives and faith that will be ruined. Obviously, you see that he sent messengers. I underlined the S. He didn't send one messenger. He sent messengers. How can you be more blatant than this? Why wasn't he discreet? Most probably because he was thinking, oh, I'm the king. I'm the king. I'll do what I want. I'll do what I please. You know, it's just like sending texts for illegal activities or sending texts for illicit relationships using a postpaid number. That's practically what this is all about. I remember a governor of Palawan who is now a fugitive to the law. He cannot be found. And guess what nailed him? Globe Telecom sending a list of the numbers he has been calling with his postpaid phone, and he has been calling an assassin. The number of the assassin, because the assassin was caught. And so the numbers were there. The length of time he talked with them, a few minutes before he was killed, a few minutes after he was killed, or the political enemy was killed. That's what David was doing. He sent messengers. Sent messengers. Blatant. Not discreetly. He wasn't even concerned about anything. The measure of a man's real character is what he would do if he knew he would never be found out. Let's all read this together again. The measure of a man's real character is what he would do if he knew he would never be found out. That's why he wasn't caring about these things. He wasn't caring about the souls around him. He didn't care about the messenger. He didn't care about the faith of this messenger. He didn't care about Bathsheba. He didn't care about what relation he had to the court of King David. He didn't care about the faith of Uriah and his family. Uriah was actually not just one of the 30 mighty men of David. Uriah was actually a Hittite. He was not Israelite. He was Canaanite. But he converted to the Israeli faith. He converted to Judaism. He wanted to worship the one true God. But David didn't think about that. He was now a predator. He was not fighting the battles, the wars against that darkness in the depths of our souls. And I think that's very important for us to understand. He wasn't thinking about the reputation of God to the other countries around. He wasn't thinking about his reputation itself. And I think that's something very important to understand. Now, sometimes in the house, we have high decibel arguments, and it's heard by the neighbors. And I get convicted because, wow, what was I thinking? The neighbors could hear me. High decibel arguments. I wasn't even thinking of their salvation. All I was thinking about was my temper. What is God dealing with us? What is the Lord trying to deal with each and every one of us? Are we fighting the battles of God? The wars of God? Against the predators within? That's why you will notice David was really blatant about this. Bathsheba was purifying herself from her monthly uncleanness. What does this mean? She just had her menstruation, and so she is very fertile. Did David even think about this? No. Probably he was saying, oh, I'm King David. I can do what I want to do. And that's a tragedy, friends. When we think that we can just do what we want to do, we no longer care, we become predators within our hearts. And I think that's very important to realize. We cannot play around with the darkness within. That's why very important that we were listening to the previous messages we were able to deal with, because oftentimes we forget that we cannot play around with the flesh. Let's all read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. Or do you not know that the one who joins himself to a prostitute is one body with her? For he says, let's all read together, the two shall become one flesh. But the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with him. Verse 18, flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body. There was a study done by an immunologist, Fred Hutchinson Cancer Center, and they took samples from 120 women who had never had sons. They found that 21% of these women had male DNA. They never had sons. The women were then categorized into four groups according to pregnancy history. Group A had only daughters. Group B had one or more miscarriages. Group C had induced abortions. And group D had never been pregnant before. The prevalence of male chimerism, I don't know how this is really pronounced, was considerably greater in group C. Anybody who knows how this is pronounced? Any doctors here? Anyway, doesn't matter. The prevalence of male microchimerism was considerably greater in group C, although it was still present in each group. Group A, 8%. Group B, 22%. Group C, 57%. And Group D, 10%. The conclusions of this study noted that the possible sources of male microtumorism included known pregnancies, miscarriages, vanished male twin, or sexual intercourse. This means that through intercourse alone, there's a potential for women to hold on to male genes and DNA within their organs and bloodstreams for their entire life. Wow. Look at this verse. And look at that study. What does the verse say? Do you not know that the one who joins himself to a prostitute is one body with her? What's our theme? Be pure. Fight God's battles. And so David sent this word to Joab. Send me Uriah the Hittite. And so Joab sent him to David. When Uriah came, make the long story short, he tried to entice Uriah to go home and have sex with his wife. But what happened was that he did not. And this is one thing we have to understand, friends. We must fight God's war against the proud ways of the world. We must fight God's war against the proud ways of the world. Here is David, the military strategist. Here is David, the expert planner when it comes to attack and counterattack. I mean, he learned well after being a fugitive from Saul. He learned well going through the land of Israel. He understood what it meant to be strategic, but right now he was using this on moral issues. He said, send me Uriah the Hittite. Go down to your house, wash your feet. What does it mean? Just, it's a euphemism for, you know, have sex with your wife. Problem was, he did not go down to his house. I'm sure he was, you know, furious. I'm sure it was mind-blowing to him. How in the world can this guy not go down to his wife? His wife is very beautiful. Can you imagine what was going in the mind of David? He wasn't thinking of that. Why? Because he was proud of his ways. He was using the ways of the world. He was a great schemer. He was a great strategist. He was proud that he had the human wisdom. He was proud. He was going to plan this, do that. Fall back position number one. Fall back position number two. It doesn't work. Fall back position number three. And so since he didn't go down the next day, he asked him, haven't you just come from a military campaign? Why didn't you go home? I like this quote. Let's all read it together. Presidents get in trouble not for what they do that is wrong, but for what is wrong that they try to cover up. That's how you still don't know who the real father of our possible presidential candidate is. Gossip goes around. Oh, is she the daughter of Marcos? Is she the daughter of this, the daughter of that? Grace Poe. We don't know. There are many things in life. You know, many things. The Be Nice side, Grace Poe side. Who else is the candidate? Mar Rojas. We all have something we want to cover up. Let's not point the finger at them. Let's point the finger at ourselves. We want to cover it up. Just like David. He was proud of his ways, his worldly ways of covering up. Just like each and every one of us. We don't want to open up our lives to God. We don't want to open up our hearts to God. We don't want to surrender to God and say, Lord, change me. Lord, you know, scrutinize my life, my heart. Lord, search my heart, purify my heart. No, that's far from the situation. Even David had a difficult time. And so he asks Uriah, and this is the answer of Uriah. Let's all read it. The one in yellow, the ark in Israel and Judah are staying in tents. And my commander, Joab, and my lord's men are camped in the open country. How could I go to my house to eat and drink and make love to my wife? As surely as you live, I will not do such a thing. Bam! Here is a guy who could control himself, talking to a king who could not control himself. Slap on the face, right? Is it possible that Uriah heard whispers around? Possibly kaya? Of course, that's Beebo Montaña's version. That is not in the NIV. That is not in the New American Standard. But in Beebo Montaña's version, allow me some license here, poetic license. Is it possible that Uriah heard some whispers? Oh, Bathsheba was sent for by the king. Messengers arrived. And you know what time she went home? Maybe 4, 3 a.m. Friends, sometimes we don't want to open up our hearts to God. We don't want Him to come into our lives and really, you know, show us what we need to transform and change within. And here we see a rebuke from Uriah, who had control, and the king of the chosen people of God, Israel, could not control himself. This was a rebuke. As I said, David had several wives at this point in his life. But he was proud. He was saying, oh, I can get away with this. I can strategize. I can scheme. I can do this. I can be proud of the ways of humanism. So he doesn't stop. Fall back position number two. Plan A doesn't work. Let's go to plan B. Stay here one more day. Tomorrow I will send you back. And so at David's invitation, he ate and drank with him, and David made him drunk. Tagay, Uriah. Tagay. Tagay, Uriah. Isa pa. Isa pa. Isa pa. Kaya. You know, kaya mo yan. But again, God is in the business of interrupting our lives. God is in the business of crossing our paths. So it looks like Uriah drank too much. He went on to sleep on his mat among his master's servants. He did not go home. Plan B doesn't work. His ways were the ways of the world. War strategies were not working. He was proud of it. The adultery of David's heart is something we can truly relate with, because oftentimes we think, oh, I can get away with this. We think, I can be unfaithful in my priorities towards God and I can get away with this. I can be unfaithful in my communion with God, in my devotions with God, in my relationship with God, and I can get away with this. I can scheme through this. I can be unfaithful in my thought life and I can get away with it. I can be careless with my words, with my actions. Oh, I can get away with it. Friends, we cannot. we cannot get away with it. Sometimes we're thinking, oh, I can just, you know, set aside my priorities of evangelism and discipleship in my office. I must just focus on this promotion. I must just focus on this at the expense of all these time of going out with our D group. No need for that. I must focus on my business. Again, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that seeking a promotion is wrong. By all means, let us pursue to glorify God in our work. If we're promoted, praise God. I'm not saying that we should not seek profits, return on investment. I'm not saying that we should not take care of our customers and clients. Let's do all of that, but first, let's ask ourselves the question. What's the main thing? Because the main thing is to keep the main thing, right? The main thing is to keep the main thing. But the question is, what's the main thing? What's the main thing? Is it evangelism, discipleship? Or is it stepping on my co-employees so I get the promotion? Is it evangelism or discipleship? Or is it, you know, cut corners so that I can get more profits at the expense of the satisfaction of my customers? Or maybe forget evangelism and discipleship. Let's go to evangeligaw. Kasi cute siya. He's so cute. Evangeligaw natin. Or evangiflirt. Either or, you know. And sometimes we think, oh, it's just the men who are so prone to this temptation, adultery. Oh, I'm sorry. It's just that men are more visual and women are more emotional. That's why you notice 99% of pornographic material is for male, not for women. Why? Well, just ask the ladies here. I don't think you're really turned on by these skinless frog-like Mr. Universe, Mr. Olympics. Most ladies say, ay, kadiri. Yeah? That's why porn doesn't work for women. Yeah? You notice? Very rare would I hear a lady saying, wow, ang ganda ng mga definitions. Yung kanyang biceps, triceps, and all the seps. Naglalab. Wow! Most women just like that. Abs. That's it. But, you know, kahit payat ito, basta may abs, okay na. You know, pwede na. But for men, wow. It's visual. You know, someone passes by. Depends on taste, of course. Someone passes by and wearing, you know, very whatever. Men will automatically, you know this? I mean, let's admit it. Men are visual. But women can also commit adultery. You notice, most novels are devoured by women. You notice, 90% of those who buy novels, I have not yet heard of a man, a real man, buying these novels. But women, they devour these novels, this, you know, telenovelas, you know. Wow, you know. That's why women, we can also, or we, oh my, I'm sorry. Women can commit adultery, maybe emotional adultery. We love it when, you know, we hear people say, you know what? I like your hair. Diba? I like your earrings. Ooh, feels so nice. I like your nail polish. We love that. Not we, women love it, again. So what are we saying here? We can all commit the same adulterous sin, whether male or female. It can be real adultery in the sense of lust, but it can be lusting for emotional adultery. And that's something that must be realized, friends. So once again, what's our theme? Be pure. Fight God's battles. So once again, we come to this portion we're in the morning. Since plan A doesn't work, plan B didn't work, finally it's plan C. Let's all read this together. Just the portion in yellow. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it with Uriah. In it he wrote, "Put Uriah out in front where the fighting is fiercest. Then withdraw from him so he will be struck down and die." So that's exactly what happened. Uriah was sent to the front line. Then the soldiers withdrew. They were just there. And they died. It was murder in the first degree. Plinano niya. Why was so desperate? First, and we have to understand that we need to fight God's battle against self-protection. We need to fight God's battle against self-protection. Why? Because clearly, when David sent this death sentence through a letter by the hand of Uriah, wherein he died, obviously it was desperation on his part, because it says in this verse that the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death according to the Levitical law, according to the Pentateuch, according to the Old Testament law, the adulterer is going to be put to death. And if David is found out, he could be stoned to death. That's why right now he was so desperate, and he definitely had to move fast, because he was no longer concerned about anything else except himself. That's why to be pure, we must fight God's battle against self-protection. To be pure, we must fight God's battle against self-protection. That's why you notice he was in a hurry. He had to bring Bathsheba into his household immediately after the time of mourning. He wasn't wasting time. When it was over, David brought her to his house and she became his wife and bore him a son. Drastic action had to be taken fast. He was in a hurry, because the faster he did this, it would be, you know, more unclear to the people around him, who will start counting, by the way. They will start counting, oh, how many months? Okay, Bathsheba gave birth. And if we count 9 months, or was it 9 months? He was in a hurry. He was thinking of self-preservation. And guess what? This thing that David had done displeased the Lord. The thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Friends, let us not allow these deceptions to come into our lives. Let us not allow these lies being peddled around the place, saying that pleasure that is immoral is more enjoyable. I think that's something we must always remember, because Hollywood is giving us all these lies again and again and again. That's why even as a young teenager, I experienced this kind of a lie. I was looking at all these portrayals in television, movies, magazines, and it all looked so exciting. You see the scenes, the scenarios, man meets woman, illicit relationship, they rendezvous, they meet up, and when they see each other, wow. And so all of this was affecting my psyche, and so I lived a life of immorality. I picked it up from my father, who himself brought me as a very young, teenager, maybe I was, 13, 14 years old. He brought me to my first nude show. Somewhere here in Vivi Sullivan. They said it was a fashion show, but all the women were wearing mosquito nets. Fashion show, pero mosquiterong suot. So my father practically raised me up in that kind of an environment. I would listen to his conversation with his friends, and what would they talk about? Immoral and illicit relationships. Clandestine. And so I was thinking, wow, this is probably the life. This is the image. This is the definition of a macho guy. And so what happens is I went deep into this kind of a lifestyle. I had girlfriends, and yet I was still sleeping with prostitutes. I had venereal disease twice. And guess what? It wasn't pleasurable. It wasn't as exciting as it is being portrayed in Hollywood. In fact, when I would compare the pleasure of that experience and the pleasure I have with my wife right now, it's like heaven and hell. Of course, with my wife, it's heaven, not the other way around, just to be clear about that. But that's exactly how it is. Friends, been there, seen it, done that, it is a lie. Because God is the author of pleasure, for crying out loud. God invented pleasure. God invented sex. God wants us to have an abundant life. God wants us to have a life of purpose. But the problem is if we allow these lies to permeate our beings, to permeate our psyche, to permeate the deepest recesses within ourselves, friends, then we will be going the way of David. Susanna Wesley is the mother of John Wesley, the greatest evangelist, together with George Whitefield during the 1700s. They practically evangelized in England and in America. And John Wesley was raised up by a godly mother, despite having a lot of children, if I'm not mistaken, 14 or 13, somewhere along those figures. But despite that, she would have time with God. And she said this, let's all read it together. Whatever weakens your reason, impairs the tenderness of your conscience, obscures your sense of God, and takes off the relish of spiritual things, that to you is sin. Friends, let's ask ourselves that question. What weakens our reason? Are we being enticed by the ways of the world? Are we being enticed by the purpose of the world? The priorities of the world, are we being enticed by the way it's being done in the office? The lifestyles of worldliness in the office, are we being enticed by the business climate? Are we being enticed by this obsession with profit at the cost of principle? Are we allowing our conscience, the tenderness of our conscience, to be impaired, wherein we become calloused? We're thinking that we no longer need to prioritize discipleship and evangelism, we need not prioritize these basic major principles that we need to put first in our lives. Whatever obscures your sense of God. Friends, are we starting to build that predator within? Whatever takes off the relish of spiritual things. When we no longer hunger for the word. When we no longer hunger to hear the word. When we need to be entertained. That to you is sin. Be pure. Fight God's battle against the purpose of the self, against the predator within, against the proud ways of the world, against the protection of the self. Be pure and fight God's battles. Friends, I'm not saying that we can do this on our own. We cannot. We need the grace of God. We need the power of God. We need to understand that we are sinners. And that we are not just saved by faith alone. We are sanctified by faith in Christ alone, friends. We have been inadequate, and these sins have a penalty. They have consequences in eternity. We pay the price in eternity. We pay the price here on earth. After this, David reaped the consequences. His own son rebelled against him. His own son plotted to kill him. His own son ravaged all his women, the concubines of David. They were ravaged by his own son. Then finally, his son was killed by Joab, the guy he ordered to kill Uriah. Friends, the most painful of all consequences would be the eternal consequence of eternal damnation. That's why Jesus died on the cross in Calvary, offering us forgiveness, offering us a new heart, transformation by the power of His blood. The ball is in our hands, whether we will receive that gift, that offer of forgiveness. Let's all stand up at this moment. Father, we thank you for opening up our hearts. We ask for your forgiveness if our mind has been darkened. We ask for your forgiveness, Lord, if we have made all sorts of excuses. We ask for your forgiveness, O God. We thank you, Lord, for opening our minds and our hearts, enabling us to understand that indeed nothing is hidden from you. Lord, we ask for your grace upon us. We know, Jesus, that we have sinned against you. Whether it's emotional adultery, whether it's mental adultery, whether it's spiritual adultery, whether it's physical adultery, we have sinned against you. We have brought hurt to your heart, O Jesus. but you allowed the story of David to be recorded. You allowed the failure of David to be written, to be exposed, to be brought before us from history to history. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the life and the failures of King David, because we see the very failures in our own hearts, in our own minds. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can come before you in full transparency. We can come before you, Lord, with open hearts. Lord, we ask that you scrutinize our hearts, search our hearts. We pray, Lord Jesus, that we will truly look upon the inner recesses within our deepest beings. For indeed, Jesus, you are our sanctification. Fill us, Lord Jesus. Fill us with your presence. Fill us with your love. Fill us with your power. We want to be pure. We know we need to fight your battles against the purpose of ourself, against the predator within, against the proud ways of the worldliness, against the protection of the self, Lord. But Lord, we know that this is only possible by your strength. Lord, fill us with your nearness, your intimacy. Fill us with your word. Fill our minds, fill our hearts, so it does not drift. Lord, our words, our actions. Lord Jesus, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, Lord. And we know, Lord, that we can truly face the darkness within. And Lord, we know that we will rise above the spiritual adulteries within. Lord, we know that we cannot love anyone more than you, Lord. We cannot love anything, any material thing, any possession, any treasure. We cannot love it more than you. We cannot love any job, any position more than you. We should not love anything more than you, Lord Jesus. Because you are the real source of life. You are the real source of joy and peace. Lord, we commit you our individual families. We commit you our hearts. Lord, we pray for each and every person. Lord, we pray for those who are single. Lord Jesus, they're going through struggles. Lord Jesus, have mercy on those who are single. Lord, have mercy on the teenagers, the children. Have mercy on the young adults who are single. Lord, have mercy. Fill them, Lord, with your presence. Fill them with your word. Fill them with the priorities, Lord, of the kingdom. Fill them, Lord Jesus, that they may not be enticed by the evil one. Because you are the creator of pleasure, and you desire that in your time, in your ways, Lord, we will have the pleasures that you have prepared for us. Holy pleasure, Lord. Lord, we commit you the marriage of each and every couple here. We commit you, husband and wife. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you will truly move in a special way within each and everyone. Move in a powerful way, Lord God. We pray that husband and wife, Lord, will be filled with your word. Husband and wife will be filled with your love, with holiness. We pray that husband and wife will truly understand that you desire abundant life for us. You desire a full life. You desire that we live according to your power, your blessings, Lord Jesus. We thank you. And Father, we just commit you each and every household. We also commit you, Lord, the financial needs of each and every household, Lord. We know that you are greater than this need. We know that you're able. You are God. We can love you. We can trust you. We can depend on you more than anything in this world for our finances. We commit you our health, healing. We ask for your grace. Even relationships. Father, we thank you. You heard our prayers. We acknowledge the answer. We receive the answer by faith. By faith, Lord, we want to please you, for without faith it is impossible to please you. And Lord, we just walk by faith. We know you heard our prayers and you answered them in the name of your Son, our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ.